Okay, good evening. Confessions of a Female Stoogephile. I did it. I saved my money and also took up a collection from friends and family. And I went to the annual Three Stooges convention in Travose, Pennsylvania. My coworkers teased me. My husband uttered many discouraging words. This was in the early 90s. It was my second husband. And even threatened to accompany me on my stooge pilgrimage. My in-laws were scandalized. My own family was somewhat bemused, but contributed generously to my stooge scholarship fund. I don't remember that, but if I say it, it's probably true. I planned my special weekend months in advance. I lost sleep, sitting up making lists of stuff I'd need to shop for and mail in advance to the Ramada in Travose, so I wouldn't have to schlep too much when I left work early on that long-awaited Friday to pick up my rental car and head off to Stooge Heaven. I am the only female Stoogephile I know. I've become aware, through my membership in the Three Stooges fan club, that there are a few female Stoogephiles out there, but we are certainly a very rare breed. Most women don't like the Three Stooges. Professor Don Morlin, who was on hand at the convention, so to speak, is one of several people who have studied the reasons why women don't like the Stooges. The seemingly gratuitous violence, the lowbrow puns, and physical slapstick are only a few of the main reasons. Professor Morlin made headlines in 1992 when he announced that it was the Three Stooges, not Charlie Chaplin, who first released a satirization of Hitler on film. When Professor Morlin screamed, "You nasty spy," at the Stooge convention, I proudly spotted two Hitler references in it that he and other worthy scholars and Stoogephiles had previously missed. My discovery was just one of the many wonderful high points in a terrific weekend of absolute Stooge gluttony. The Three Stooges in 3D, collectibles, actresses who'd appeared in Stooge films, Stooge impersonators. The curly guy was absolutely amazing. Banquets, autographs, photo ops galore. I couldn't control myself. In crowded rooms that weekend, Stooge-like utterances such as "woo" and "me me 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 me" kept escaping from my lips. Often, other Stoogephiles responded in kind. I wandered from screening room to screening room, watching film after film, listening to guest speakers, listening to a woman play Larry Fine's Stradivarius violin so beautifully, it made my heart leap. Meeting Mo Howard's son, scrutinizing Stooge memorabilia way beyond the reaches of my very slim wallet, and feeling my intense love for Shemp growing by the hour. It's a little awkward being a Stoogephile. Most people think you're stupid. Nearly all women shun you and your stupid proclivity. Being a Stoogephile is something one doesn't generally mention in polite company. But this particular weekend, I basked in appreciative smiles and kind words from the many, many male Stoogephiles who were so pleased to meet me and who were so happy to see a female who gets it. The Stooges are the best. It's something I just can't really explain. Most Stoogephiles prefer curly, and I've met many who've spoken at length about the wonders of Larry, the stooge in the middle. For me, however, Shemp is the most fabulous, and Mo is the most awesome. Mo, the most correct sadist of the 20th century. Every time he utters a stern threat, every time he pokes an eye or slaps you, you know it's right. I'm proud to be a Stoogephile. I subscribe to the Three Stooges Journal, and you can contact me if you want the address. This was well over 20 years ago. I don't know if that still exists. I collect tapes of the Three Stooges, favoring the very early films with Ted Healy and Bonnie Bunnell. Did you know that there was once a female stooge? The critics liked to diss Bonnie, but she was great. Calling her a stoogette isn't fair. She held her own in her unique, sleazy brilliance. And Ted Healy, who is generally credited with assisting the Stooges to famedom, and conversely, a very raw deal from Hollywood, long story, who was a star vaudevillian, is without doubt one of the great unsung comedy stars of this century. I live in Brooklyn, New York, home of the Stooges. When I'm feeling very low, I visit Stooge sites. Mo Howard's former address on Coney Island Avenue is a favorite. I look at the crumminess of my surroundings and derive spiritual comfort in knowing that from these humble environs, true genius was bred. True, it's a harsh and ugly world. Yet from this harsh and ugly world, such harsh and ugly gems as Mo, Larry, Curly, Shemp, Joe, and Curly Joe, and others, were born and were preserved by movie cameras for what one hopes will be eternity. Because you know it's right. I sold this. I got a lot of money for it. Okay, let's see. I'm in France now. I'm not in Brooklyn anymore. But I lived there for 15 years. I really liked it. I liked where I lived. Didn't like Manhattan that much. Okay, now here's something more of Confessions of a Female Stoogephile. July 28, 1993. Dear Diary. Finally, a few moments to record my impressions of this past weekend, the annual Three Stooges Convention in Trevos, Pennsylvania. I can't believe how my love for Shemp has grown each year. It's been 13 or 14 years since I became a Stoogephile, and about 6 years since I fell for Shemp over all the other Stooges. In 1977 or 1978, my punk rock singer boyfriend and I got drunk at CBGB's, and he just went on and on about how cool the Stooges are. He talked and talked. I was so in love. I hung on his every word. Maybe because I loved him so much, when he dumped me, I transferred my love to the Stooges he loved. If I could still afford a shrink, I guess I'd explore this. along with my reasons for choosing Shemp as my favorite back in 1987 or so, just after the stock market crash, just after I lost my job. Not in Wall Street, by the way. I had the sense to get out before the crash, but the one after that. During a time that is largely lost to me, because I spent most of the next 4 years in a sleazy alcoholic haze. And Shemp is the sleaziest stooge. It all makes sense somehow. I speak of Shemp as if he were still alive, although he died 2 years before I was born. The man with a fear of doctors died suddenly of a heart attack. He flopped over on someone else in the car and burned them with his cigar. How fitting. Even in death, an act of violence. Violence that is both profoundly disturbing as well as it is comic. Ah, Shemp. Good thing you aren't alive today. I'd become one of those scary groupies. A stalker. I'd want to get close enough to smell you. At the convention, Diana Darren, who appeared in 9 Stooges short movies, gave a brief talk and then asked the audience for questions. And it was difficult not to publicly expose myself as the freaky female I truly am by asking her what I wanted to know. What did Shemp smell like? Can't believe I wrote that. She said Shemp was the warmest, the most outgoing, probably her favorite. He was a Gemini like me, actually. I could almost be jealous. She got to touch Shemp, to really see him, to smell him. Shemp's real-life wife didn't like Ted Healy, who was generally credited with giving the Stooges their big break, so she urged him to quit the trio, and Curly, who was Moe's and Shemp's real-life brother, also joined. Shemp went on to make many, many movies. I got to see one at the convention this past weekend. I don't know what it was titled, but I think the Roman numerals at the beginning of the movie meant that it was originally released in 1934. Shemp co-starred with a tiny woman whose name, like the movie's title, also escapes me. And they played a couple of down-on-their-luck vaudevillians named Cook and Butler, who mistakenly end up working as, you guessed it, a cook and a butler, yet who are determined to see it through in order to get something to eat and a little money. The movie blew my mind. It was wonderful. Truly, truly funny. But the two things I liked best about it were, one, the way the little woman kept slapping Shemp around, verbally humiliating him, and in general, dominating him, and two, seeing Shemp nearly naked from the waist up. While wearing only a collar and bow tie, a shirt front and cuffs minus his butler jacket, Shemp attempted to follow the little woman's instructions and stuff the turkey. While I was laughing at the things he put into the turkey, I found myself staring in amazement at his arms and what I could see of his chest and torso. Gorgeous. Shemp had a great body in 1934. Skinny, but with good muscles. Very white, smooth skin, and hairless. And it was so cool, that great body, combined with that ugly face. Even better still, he sported a really wacky Shemp hairstyle. His hair was very long, too long, and had been greased back, but the grease wasn't holding. And long black clumps of slightly curly, very greasy hair fell constantly into his face. I watched in amazement, very aware that I was becoming sexually aroused. He looked like a sexy punk rocker. It all makes sense now. Ah, the emotion. I can't believe I wrote this. This is crazy. But it's sincere. And it's true, I was there. Ah, Shemp. Wonderful Shemp. Shemp of my dreams. Shemp, who was usually on the receiving end of Moe's violence, but who often suffered from self-inflicted injuries as a result of his stupidity, his ineptitude, his laziness, all his bad, sleazy traits. And like all the other Stooges, Shemp took his lumps from Moe, this century's most correct sadist. I can still hear my punk rock singer boyfriend's voice, his words a little slurred from booze or beer or whatever we were drinking so much of that night ago, years ago, saying, "That slap or poke or other messed up punishment comes from Mo, and you find yourself cheering because you know it's right." A hierarchy of sadism. Mo the top. And the drunken punk rock singer's voice, his boozy breath in my ear, ranting stuff like, "The gay liberation movement never gave proper credit to the Three Stooges for bringing the gay lifestyle into the mainstream of American consciousness." It all comes back to me in a bizarre swirl of images. Three men in a bed together, phallic instruments of torture. Everyone gets theirs on their butts. Close up of an iron being used to brand someone's ass, maybe even Moe's ass, to which he responds with an oh-so-correct round of punishment, and on and on. I never got over that punk rock singer, the way he deflowered and then dumped me. I had fantasies of capturing him somehow and beating the living crap out of him. I became a man-hater right after my first man. A man-hater with violent fantasies. A man-hater who nonetheless still craved men. A man-hater who loved watching the Stooges beat the crap out of each other because I know it's right.